Benvenuti a una nuova puntata di Dr. Penis. Oggi abbiamo un onore, un prestigio, un qualcosa di incredibile. Nel nostro studio a Roma è venuta una personalità, la storia dell'implantologia protesica mondiale, il professor Wilson è quello che nel mondo ha impiantato più protesi, è quello che ha creato questa sorta di ultra professionista dell'implantologia protesica, è una di quelle personalità alle quali io personalmente mi sono sempre ispirato. I remember 20 years ago in Rome, I remember very well you come, professor, to have three implants in the department of University of Rome, and I was very young. I remember very well your figure, your imagine, and I think in that moment I decided to having this professional training, this professional journey in my life. I would like if you can describe to our audience what is the penile implant, and speaking about the history, when the first penile implant started, and then how the penile implant evolving during the time.
It's a great subject, and this is a great year to do it because this is the 50th birthday of the three-piece inflatable penile prosthesis.
Sono 50 anni, dice il professore. Sorry, professor, I translate. Sono 50 anni che le protesi sono in commercio e ovviamente il professor Wilson questi 50 anni li ha visti tutti e ce li racconta.
So the guy that invented it was a professor of urology at Baylor University in Houston, Texas, and it came out and it was all silicone, and it wasn't very good. Yeah. And it had to have a great big abdominal incision to put it in because we had to run the tubing all over through the inguinal canals. It was a lot of work and it broke all the time.
And how long is the time of the implant?
Well, that was 73 and I had just finished my residency and I was looking for something to focus on, and I went to the course and I came back and I did my first implant in 1974 after I had gone to the course.
Yeah.
And then the implant wasn't really very good until about the mid-80s. And in the mid-80s, it got much better, mechanically reliable, and then we got a second company. So we had the original company, which was American Medical Systems, then we had the Mentor prosthesis.
Yeah.
And the prosthesis got much, much better and much, much more reliable. And then over the years, it's continued to be enhanced. But the AMS one was invented in 73, and the Mentor one was invented in 83. And then we never had another prosthesis until 2019.
Yeah.
Almost 30 years later, and then now we have the Rigicon prosthesis. And all three of the prostheses look the same, but they have different characteristics and different enhancements. And so what I'm doing here in Rome today, visiting you, is to try to convince you to try this new prosthesis, which I believe is as good or better than the two that are on the market, and has a lifetime replacement warranty, which neither of the other two have.
Yes.
So if you're paying cash for your implant and it breaks, it doesn't matter when it breaks or why it breaks, it's replaced for free.
Yes, nice. Ok, il professor Wilson ci ha detto che le protesi ovviamente hanno 50 anni, i primi impianti erano degli impianti molto complessi, bisognava fare delle incisioni addominali molto molto importanti. Inizialmente il dispositivo che avevamo a disposizione era il dispositivo della MS, successivamente la Mentor è stata sviluppata e fino al 2019 nessun altro impianto, nessun'altra azienda produceva questo tipo di device. Dal 2019 c'è la possibilità di impiantare, e domani faremo un impianto con il professore in sala operatoria di Rigicon, sarà un impianto, il nostro millesimo impianto, it will be the 9000 implant tomorrow with you.
Really?
Yes.
You're 1000.
Yes. Yes.
You have 10 more to go before you beat me.
Yeah. Perfect. E ovviamente il professore ci dice, lui ha una grandissima esperienza, prima di batterlo ci vogliono ancora 10 anni. E domani faremo questo impianto. Rigicon, a differenza degli altri due device, è uscito sul mercato nel 19, ha una garanzia a vita, quindi la differenza è molto simile agli altri impianti, però viene garantito a vita. And something about the approach, the penoscrotal approach, the infrapubic approach. What do you think about? There are differences between the two approaches. Which approach do you prefer? Speak about this topic.
Well, we all, and back in the old days, Dr. Antonini, we all did it infrapubic.
Yeah.
Because that's the way Dr. Scott invented it. And it wasn't until about 1981 that Dr. Scott was operating on a patient that had had 5 previous operations, yeah, through the abdominal incision, and he had a complication. So he thought, I'm going to try to do it a different way so I don't get this complication. So then he invented the penoscrotal. And the penoscrotal took over because it's easier for the doctor to do, but it's not easier for the patient to have.
Yeah.
So that's the distinction.
Yeah.
And you probably should translate to there and then I'll continue.
Okay. Praticamente il professore ci dice che inizialmente gli interventi erano degli interventi molto molto indaginosi, erano delle incisioni addominali per impiantare la protesi. Proprio per questo motivo si è passati ad un approccio penoscrotale, che era un approccio più facile ovviamente per il chirurgo, però era molto molto più difficile da tollerare, perché un'incisione scrotale è un qualcosa che dà un grosso discomfort al paziente, quindi il paziente lo accettava meno bene in termini poi di post-operatorio, di dolori post-operatori.
So, up until Dr. Perito went into practice, I think the statistics were like in the year 2000, which is about when he went into practice, I think the statistics were 85% were done penoscrotal and only 15% the original way, which was infrapubic.
Yeah.
But infrapubic with a large incision. And then the young Paul Perito went into practice and he invented this tiny little incision to do it through, and he began teaching everybody. And he's really changed the paradigm, because now I think it's about 65-35. Penoscrotal 65-35 infrapubic, and all of them are using his minimally invasive technique.
Yes.
But it's not an easy technique for the doctor to learn, as you know.
Yes, yes.
And it's not an easy technique to learn how to be quick through that tiny little incision. So you're to be congratulated for doing 1,000 through that tiny little incision. Not me. I'm still doing penoscrotal.
Yes, yes. Il professore ci dice che inizialmente anche l'accesso infrapubico, che è un accesso più confortevole soprattutto in termini di risultati per il paziente, era un accesso un po' più ampio. Successivamente Perito ha codificato questa tecnica con un accesso mini-invasivo, quindi una piccola incisione, entra solamente il dito dentro l'incisione, ha cominciato a sviluppare questa tecnica infrapubica e a insegnare la tecnica infrapubica, a disseminare la tecnica infrapubica. Il professor Wilson si è congratulato con me perché ha detto che non è facile, è una tecnica, molti si improvvisano, io conosco tante persone che iniziano a fare questa tecnica non avendo avuto un training né con Perito né con me in Italia, si improvvisano a fare questa tecnica. Giustamente il professore dice che non è assolutamente una tecnica facile, si è congratulato perché domani faremo il nostro millesimo impianto con la tecnica infrapubica. Do you like Rome? Italy.
Oh, I love Italy, and I love
yes
every city in Italy.
Yes.
Yeah, it It's the best.
Yes.
The food is good. The women are beautiful. The wine is terrific. What's wrong with this country?
Yes. Tomorrow we have the implant. Tonight we have a good dinner together. I hope you enjoy your stay in Rome. And I want to thank you again for your presence, for staying with me in Rome. For me is the greatest honor you can give me.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. Thank you.